Great. Well, good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the UBC session. It's wonderful to be back here at New Horizons. It's wonderful to have the opportunity to close the conference with the second of these sessions. And I would like to say how pleased I am and delighted with our panelists today, and that Nick and Eve and Catharine have agreed to join us and contribute to this discussion. Somewhat proud and simultaneously slightly embarrassed that we have an all-English panel today. So as the last session of this conference, the UBC session was designed to have a slightly less conventional, slightly unorthodox format. And this year we're going to focus on some video footage that we've been shooting since Christmas, looking at some of the defining psychological effects that we see in gambling. We call these cognitive distortions, and their significance is really quite far-reaching. Some of the major psychological treatments for problem gambling, so Bob Ladisser's cognitive behavioral therapy approach, aims to identify and correct faulty beliefs about the game. Within some of the major theoretical models of problem gambling, like Blazinski's pathways model, cognitive distortions play a key role in the development of this disorder. And within responsible gambling, challenging these myths around gambling and identifying and correcting those beliefs is a key feature of RG messaging. But at the same time, if players are completely immersed and absorbed in the game, that may interfere with their ability to engage with these tools and engage with that messaging. So what we'd like to do today is use some films, some short films that we've shot, as a kind of jumping off point for some discussions around those kinds of issues. And after we look at each film, I'll invite the panel to comment, and then we'll broaden it out, and I very much hope we can take some questions about distortions from the floor as well. So without further ado, we'll go into the first video, and here we're really looking at the kind of big daddy of gambling distortions. This is the gambler's fallacy. So we can see this effect across many different forms. It cuts across all forms of gambling, but in different other areas of decision making as well. We see this most clearly in games where there are two possible outcomes. So we could have done coin flipping with heads or tails, but actually we've chosen roulette as our way of visualizing these effects. So in the video that you're about to see, this is in four UBC undergraduates, inexperienced, not regular gamblers. And as you watch this video, I'd like you to focus on the color that they're choosing, the red, black color decisions. You don't need to worry about number at all. Let's have a look at the first video, please.
Slow. I'm not. Nice. Yeah.
Okay. Yay. Okay.
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 Okay, so we can see that just from 10 or 15 minutes of footage there from roulette spins, whenever we had runs of three or four consecutive reds or three or four consecutive blacks, we can see this very clear prediction that the other outcome will be due and players betting on that other outcome. This is one of the most robust effects in the whole of human decision making. And even in my own role as the croupier in the video there, I felt myself succumbing for this effect. It's a very powerful bias. Who would like to start? Over to you, panelists.
I can start if you like.
Yeah.
So, we've done quite a lot of research on this in the past few years, and as Luke says, it's very robust, and we find it across Cambridge undergraduates, who you would think might have quite a lot of statistical knowledge, and then we find it in a community sample, and we find it in older adults, and it really is something that we just find really consistently. And it's actually, although it looks like a really simple experiment for us to run, it's actually really complicated, because not only are you guessing red or black, but each time you're also winning or losing. And we find that human behavior is also influenced by these series of wins or losses. And importantly for the gambler's fallacy, we find that people are much more prone to make these sort of fallacy decisions if they're losing. And I think this indicates why it's an important cognitive distortion to look at in gambling, because when we look at how much people bet, that's where it gets interesting. So if people are falling for the gambler's fallacy, if it's been a run of black, they're more confident that it's going to be red, and therefore they place a larger bet on this decision. And so it's likely that this the existence of this distortion might continue make people want to continue to play, might make them feel like they've got more control over the game, or that there's some element of skill, even though they know that each outcome is independent from the last.
Yeah, I think that was a very nice summary of the literature. And I think this idea of being aware that things are independent, like being able to state, oh, the house always wins, and I know these things are independent, and yet have it not influence ongoing behavior is quite interesting. It's like there's this cognitive disconnect between what people report that they know and understand, and then what they do when they're caught up in the gambling game.
Yeah, I feel that's a really important feature of this bias, that in a way these two exists seem to coexist. You can see these effects in players who understand, you know, the maths of the game, the independence of turns, inside out. And at the same time, as you see that run build up, it's such a compelling effect. It must be the other one next. And I think that's actually important for responsible gambling messaging, because you can inform players more, but it doesn't necessarily translate to turning off that that effect. I think that's something that we really need to understand more.
Well, I just want to take this moment to say, Doctor, 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 mister. Okay.
It's a shame.
Yeah, exactly. So give me a break. It's interesting what Luke says. I think now 7 years ago, I was approached to redesign a poster for a responsible gambling message in that was going to go on a wall in a casino. And actually, I think, as you probably all know, responsible gambling is something to be kind of, dealt with. But putting a poster with responsible gambling on a wall actually doesn't connect with anybody. Nobody identifies themselves as an irresponsible gambler. They're just somebody who enjoys playing games. So that's kind of why actually the Game Sense was born from the need to find a way of packaging advice, guidance, transparency, and these kind of more consumer-based and more consumer-relevant messages to deal with myths and fallacies like we've just seen on the video here. And I think it's not exactly surprising that all of us actually kind of encounter these little moments of illogical behavior. I think we probably all cross our fingers. We all talk about fate. We all talk about a number of things that don't actually make sense when you really kind of like trying to peel back the layers on it. But so game sense, yeah, as you all know, it was kind of created to kind of present transparently these myths to people and help them try and find find the truth in their behavior and inside the games themselves. And yeah, it's kind of crazy that there's a handful of us in this room that were responsible for coming up with this kind of idea, this program or initiative. Is it a place? Is it a resource center? It's kind of all of these things, and it's becoming, I think, more and more kind of omnipresent, or should become more omnipresent amongst and throughout gambling environments. But it's an interesting kind of, you know, one myth that is attempting to be kind of transparently unpackaged within, I guess, the GameSense brand.
And really one of the success stories in responsible gambling in recent years, and a homegrown success at that. Are there any comments from the floor about this particular bias, or about any? Yes, I can see one down at the front. We're slightly blinkered by the lights at the front, so raise your hands clearly.
Of course, I recognize that there is something to the gambler's fallacy, but I think it's a more subtle story than has been presented. Because as an economist, I wouldn't say that your students were guilty of the gambler's fallacy, because it doesn't matter what superstition they use to choose, the terms of the bet stay the same. It's equally good to bet red or black. Mm. There's the same odds, so it's not costing them anything to indulge in a bias of which they may be aware. It's more interesting, I think, to look at gambling situations where you would change the value of the bet if you followed the gambler's fallacy. And one area where this has been studied is in dog racing and which trap wins the race. And some early studies did produce support for the fact that in parimutuel betting, there were worse returns if you took account of what the previous result had been. But these findings haven't proven robust. And generally, these puzzlingly opposing ideas of the hot hand and the gambler's fallacy don't seem to produce patterns of returns in betting markets where the bulk of players seem to be doing the wrong thing and worsening their returns. So I don't think you can look at engagement and attachment to fallacies without considering whether and how much it's costing the player to indulge in that bias. And some of the research in responsible gambling, I think, could take that idea on board.
Yeah, I think that's a very, I think that's a fair point, but that's also something that we have tried to do within the video here in terms of the number of chips that they're betting. So you're right, you've got to choose something. You've got to choose red or black. It's 50-50. What does it matter which one you pick? But if we can see after a run of one outcome that people are actually increasing their stake on the other prediction, that does equate to increased risk that they're tolerating there, and I think that then has financial repercussions in terms of loss chasing. So I think that is important to go from an arbitrary decision up to one that impacts upon the player. Well, I think the terms here, maybe Eve, do you want to?
Yeah, so for those that maybe aren't familiar, the hot hand is this tendency to, if you're on a winning streak, to increase your bet, to continue betting because you think you're going to continue winning. And so during a game like this roulette game that we've created, people can simultaneously experience the gambler's fallacy and the hot hand. And actually, I think in our experiments, we haven't actually found the hot hand. I don't think that it's not coming through in our experiments, but it is out there in the literature. And I think that this is a very interesting individual difference measure. So I think there has been one study where they filmed casino, a roulette table, so real players in a casino, and they did find the gambler's fallacy, but they didn't find it in everyone. So some people showed the gambler's fallacy and others didn't. So then we can start to look and see, well, if you do show the gambler's fallacy, are you more likely to develop problematic gambling? And I think that in the same way of people might be differently likely to show the gambler's fallacy, in the same way they can be differently likely to show the hot hand. So they're closely related, and this makes our experiments really difficult to disentangle those effects.
I would say these are both biases in thinking about random sequences, but yeah, one is about the runs of the actual outcome, heads or tails, reds or blacks. The other is about the response to the feedback, to the winning and the losing streaks. Yeah. Yes, it's on.
Okay. You know, something that struck me when I was watching that video is that being perfectly rational when dealing with a game of pure chance is no fun. And sometimes bringing in that little level of distortion, whatever, just makes it potentially a little more fun. And then I was thinking about this morning's presentation, and I'm wondering if we don't run a risk of over-pathologizing some of this, you know, what we see as cognitive distortions. I mean, I've had people tell me that, oh, picking your own lottery numbers is a sign of impending destruction. Mm. Because, you know, that there's some distortion involved in that. So at what point do we draw a distinction between something that's, hey, just to make this a little more entertaining, and something that actually is a problem?
Exactly, yes. Yes, that's one of the messages that I really, you know, that underpinned this whole endeavor. The participants here are UBC students. These are people who don't gamble really at all, and yet we can see these effects coming through very easily. So what is the relevance of these biases to problem gambling? And I don't think the cognitive literature has gone far enough down that route yet. Are we talking about the number of different beliefs that exist? Are we talking about the frequency with which those thoughts occur to you? Are we talking more about some sort of conviction, some certainty about that particular bias? And I don't think we've started to separate those factors yet. But yeah, the fact that it's so easy to elicit these biases in everyone, I think is a question mark there.
And if I can make, hopefully, this, I have just been teaching psychology undergraduates, so it's very much in my mind, some of these issues about how does a brain as complex as the human brain deal with events that are basically unpredictable. And there's some beautiful literature thinking about deep, weighty things like issues of consciousness. How does the brain give rise to conscious awareness? Which I'm not going to give you a tedious one-hour lecture on. But within that literature, there's discussion about how the brain naturally, a brain as complex as ours, tries to make sense of random events. So that's sort of part of what our brain is almost hardwired to do. And so when things are purely random and purely by chance, it's as if our brain just wants to be able to, if anything, just make up a story to make ourselves feel better about what is happening. And I think that could play into some of the evolutionary significance of these biases. And, you know, the way in which when things actually happen in the environment, they're unlikely to be truly, truly random. And so looking at the frequency of events and trying to sort of create a map, a sort of internal representation of what's happened in the past and using that to guide your future behavior is actually normally a very adaptive thing to do. It's just sometimes in these gambling games, which are designed to really maximize uncertainty, which we find really thrilling and exciting, that part of our brain can sometimes lead us to make silly decisions.
That might be a good point to segue into our second clip. So the second clip is a bit of a gear change. We're moving towards slot machine gambling now. This is something that we do a lot of research on at the Center for Gambling Research. And this video is describing a phenomenon called the loss disguised as a win. And this has mainly been characterized in modern multi-line slot machines. The multi-line nature of slot machines enables this feature. It's also a feature that is very much linked to the sensory feedback associated with winning. The bells and whistles, the lights and sounds, how that underpins this effect. I should also say that this effect was, this video was prepared by Stephanie Chu, a graduate student at the center. So if we can roll the second tape. Okay, so for those of you who might not have encountered that effect before, I'm not sure if that was entirely clear or not from the video, what we have here is a scenario where one or two lines within the game pay out, but that payment doesn't actually cover the wager that has been placed on that trial. Nevertheless, the sensory feedback that you get to those events is very similar to the sensory feedback that you get to real wins. And this sensory feedback is a very powerful condition stimulus for many gamblers. From Steph's video, you can also see one of the psychological consequences of those features being present in the games, that our participants tended to think that they had actually won more often than they really had, presumably because of the features of those LDWs. So a very specific effect that we're talking about now.
Well, I mean, if I can just jump in, I think it's highly unsurprising that people feel like they're winning when they're clearly not. You know, the financial result is obviously a loss, but the it feels so, to me, almost deceitful of the game designer to create an experience of win when in fact a loss has occurred. I think the results of the eight wins, you know, it felt like eight wins, but it was actually only four. I mean, doesn't surprise me at all, and I'm amazed that there isn't a little bit more, I guess, responsibility on behalf of the game creators, whether it's slots or even the environment creators. And I think somebody touched on that earlier about the amount of time and money that's spent into creating the perfect environment that induces, I guess, this more liberal game playing. I'm surprised that there isn't more kind of control or intervention over what is and isn't permitted.
I think that's probably partly a consequence of how fast technology has moved and how, as regulators and how researchers, it takes us so long to do the research. I know people have been saying this during this conference, that we can't keep up with the technology.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and of course, one of the things that we've recently done with our rats, so yeah, I'm the rat woman, does research rats. That's my job, getting rats to gamble. It's a funny way to earn a living, but it pays the bills. It's actually some very serious neuroscience looking at this. So all these sensory cues that are present in casinos and in gambling games, they may, you know, just you may just assume, oh, they're just there to grab your attention, just to keep things more interesting, a little bit more fun, you know, just a harmless bit of arousal, a bit of, you know, just make it a bit more of a good time to play. But we actually, if you look at the drug addiction literature, which is way ahead of sort of looking at problem gambling, it's been more understood as an addiction for obviously a lot longer. There's been a lot of work both in human subjects and using animal subjects. And in a way, the animal literature kind of drove the human literature because we can have so much more control over what we get our animals to do and everything's much more tightly regulated. That the cues associated with taking a substance like cocaine, which believe me, rats love, those cues actually become very, what we call appetitive to the animal. They really love those cues. So even when you don't give them any drug, they get really excited about seeing the cues associated with the drug. And it's very hard to break that association once it's set up. They don't sort of go off the cues nearly as quickly as you'd think when we stop giving the drug. And just seeing those cues can cause them to enter almost like a relapse state where they start seeking drug very actively as if they're almost craving it in response to those sensory cues. Now, of course, you look at something like gambling where sensory cues are everywhere. I mean, you walk into a pachinko parlor in Japan, oh my God, the noise is deafening. It is all about sensory stimulation. And so we wondered in the rats, if we put literally bells and whistles into some of our rat gambling games, would it make a difference? And we may have thought, oh, it might just increase the number of trials that animals do, or the number of rounds of this game they're willing to play. But what we found, and we had these rats were choosing, if you like, between four different options, two of which were good in that they paid out a little bit of sugar pellets, but they paid out consistently, and when they lost, they didn't lose that much time to play. So they had 30 minutes to maximize their sugar pellet profits, and they had to sort of play it safe and go steady in order to earn as much sugar as they like. However, if they chose these other two options, they'd get larger numbers of sugar pellets immediately, but over time, those options didn't pay out nearly as well. Wins were much less frequent, and the penalties we induced, which again, these timeout penalties, which meant they had less time to earn reward overall, were much longer. So when we didn't have any bells and whistles in this task, it was just a pretty boring environment for the animals. The animals learned the game really well. So we had way over 80% of our rats could figure out that playing it safe was the best strategy. But when we started literally keeping all the odds the same, and all we did was put in a little tune and some flashing lights when the animals won, and 50% of them started choosing risky options all the time. It was the biggest behavioral effect we've ever seen. And we can like manipulate genes and stuff. Like we can do like serious and cool stuff. And all we did was make it go doo-doo-doo-doo-doo, bing, 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 bing. Like huge shift in choice behavior. And that really sort of caused us to stop and take another look at what we thought these cues were doing. They're not as harmless as maybe we thought. They can actually induce risky decision making.
Again, I think this is a scenario as well where there is increasing evidence that problem gamblers are more sensitive to these sensory effects than other players as well. And so a lot of the sort of pioneering work describing losses disguised as wins was done by Mike Dixon and Kevin Harrigan's group at Waterloo, and they've shown that problem gamblers vastly prefer playing a game set on a multi-line setting compared to exactly the same display but on a single-line mode, and that when they play on the multi-line setting, they enjoy the game more, and they actually report feeling more competent and more in control of the game. So there's a kind of a clue there as to how these effects might be working. Any questions on these sensory, or comments on these sensory aspects of gambling that we're looking at here?
Okay. Yeah, just wondering if you have done some research into the reverse being true. So you talked about the nice tune and the flashing lights, but what about the opposite of that scenario? Would it detract from the experience or cause them not to choose to play that?
If you strip the sensory feedback out,
I think I'm speaking more specifically about not necessarily stripping out the experience, but doing. I don't really want to imitate the sound, but you know, like a losing sound, the traditional wah wah wah,
yes.
You know, like that kind of scenario with no lights at that point. If that would actually have the reverse effect on them.
Well, I do think those sounds are powerfully valenced, and they're also conditioned stimuli in much the same way that the flashy jingles of the winds are. Do you know if...
There has been an experiment where they've coded the losses disguised as winds with a negative losing noise, and that gets rid of the effect. People obviously can then easily distinguish a win from a loss, and the significance of these LDWs diminishes. That was the Dixon group as well, the Waterloo group.
Thank you.
So for the third video, we're going to stick with slot machine play in the third video. This is something that we do a lot of work. We actually have some real commercially available slot machines in our casino lab out at UBC. And Spencer Murch, another grad student, at the center, has really been interested in players' attention when they play these games. The ability of the spinning reels and that continuous sensory feedback to immerse the player in this sort of trance-like state where they lose track of their surroundings, what's going on around them. In the poster that Spencer had this morning, he's looking at how we can measure that state that we call the machine zone in our experiments. But in the video that follows, we really tried to push that effect to its extreme to see exactly what players could be drawn to overlook if they're absorbed in the game. If we can roll the third video.
So, was there anything that stuck out to you about that machine you just played? Anything notable?
Very bright, music was catchy, mm-hmm. and I mean, it was fun to play for the most part.
Okay, so on some trials, you may have noticed that the clock that was in the top right-hand corner suddenly changed to be several hours later.
I never noticed that.
So, from 12 noon to 7 or 8 p.m.
Oh, okay. No, I didn't notice that at all. I looked at it a few times, but I only ever noticed when it was new.
Did you notice the clock in the top right-hand corner of the screen?
Didn't notice it at all.
I started losing way more than I thought I was betting at one point.
While you were betting 27 credits per bet, a couple of times I just started taking away money from you for no reason.
I kind of thought that might have happened, but then I wasn't sure if I had done my math wrong. I was like, I lost a lot.
I thought I noticed it getting lower than it should have.
Do you have any indication that this might not have been a fair game that you were playing?
Well, because it is kind of a simulation, I assume something might be manipulated to be not entirely fair, but as far as noticing that sum of money disappearing, I felt like it was going down a little faster than I should have, but I didn't have like a mental calculation roll.
Beyond that, the only other thing that was really going on screen besides the reels and those windows was the little messaging window in the bottom right-hand corner.
Sorry.
Did you spend any time looking at that?
No.
Okay. Yeah, it would just say things like, good luck, spinner, and you know, sorry you lose.
Yeah.
That window.
Yeah. I'm maybe very brief.
but generally didn't spend much time looking at any of the messages that were presented there.
No.
Great, so once again, those are inexperienced players. They're novice players. They're just playing that Lobster Mania simulation for a few minutes. And so they're not gonna be completely entered into that machine zone there, but we can see from this that they're pretty oblivious to a lot of features that are clearly happening on screen. And I feel that this is very important for how we convey messaging within the game. If players are absorbed in the game, we really need to pull them out of that state in order to engage them in using these tools, setting limits, and seeing how close they are to reaching those limits.
So this reminds me, I think, and this is, speaks to perhaps as psychologists, three of us, not this dude over here. What we're really mindful of might not be the same things that as operators or regulators you're mindful of. And so one of the things we're taught as undergraduates is this experiment on attention. So you might assume that you're really good at paying attention to what's going on in the world. And we've just seen here with this slot machine demonstration that actually if you're in a zone, then you're not going to be able to, well, you're not necessarily going to pay attention to what's going on around you. But it's actually really easy to elicit this effect. And there's this video that I'm pretty sure we were all shown as undergraduates where there's six people playing basketball. Three of them are wearing black T-shirts and three of them are wearing white T-shirts. And you're told to count how many times the white team throw the ball. And both teams are throwing the ball, so it's quite a demanding task. You really have to pay attention to the team in white T-shirts and see what they're doing. And then at the end of the video, it's revealed that actually a gorilla, a man in a gorilla suit, walked into the middle of the camera, danced around, kind of made some funny gestures, and walked off again. And most people who were watching the team in white will not have even noticed the gorilla walk onto the screen. So this just shows how our selective attention, how we really zone in and onto one very specific thing, even just such a simple task. And I think that speaks to this zone state, that imagine if you've entered this zone, which a lot of players talk about as being their motivation to play, I think it's unlikely that you're going to pay attention to the messaging surrounding the machine.
And I like to look at this example, and I see it through two different lenses. And this is me with my creative director hat on. This experience, you can't see the screen down here. This experience, it's the result of a really, really bad brief. It's a client who's wanting to create this environment they've got about 1,000 different messages. There's no real priority. There's no key hierarchy within those kind of stimulus. It's time, it's how much I've got in my kitty, I've got to pay attention to the reels, there's this noise, there's all these flashing lights. I just have no idea where to look. And that's, as a kind of creative, as a designer or an art director, you're taught to prioritize and use all of these stimulus to, I guess, help somebody consume the information in front of them in the right order. And it's just a chaotic environment. So that's kind of like one way of looking at it. It's the result of a terrible brief where the client just wants to get all of these different on top of each other messages in there. The other way of looking at it, I see, is a little bit more sinister. Is that environment created in that way so that you don't notice your pot diminishing, you don't notice the time slipping away, you don't notice these other messages that are, the ones that are there to kind of guide you and make more responsible decisions. But it's again designed in a way to prevent you from taking in those kind of more responsible pieces of content in that experience. And, I don't know, I'm sure it's maybe a bit of both, but that's the way I responded to that video.
Yeah, I have a similar conflict.
Mm.
I mean, there are some, again, going back to the rats, but But actually, the rat data has translated very nicely into the human data. One thing that we can do really easily with animals and have been doing for decades is just to see how much they like approaching a light that's paired with a reward. And if you run a large number of animals through this very simple task where a light comes on and reward is delivered repeatedly, and you look at how much they spend time around the light and how much they spend time focusing on the place reward comes out, the animals sort of fall into two different camps. There are those that learn, okay, the light predicts reward, but that just means I go and I hang out where the reward's coming out. And there are those who learn the light predicts reward, I love the light. And they just spend all their time sniffing, batting at, licking, chewing, all the things that rats can do to something. The light and the reward delivery is somewhat secondary. So people have shown in humans that there is also this difference where humans will, what we call sign track, I pay more attention to the stimuli predicting the reward than goal track, which is paying more attention to the reward itself. And if you sort of take that simple idea and then you look at this complicated screen, and one of our postdocs has actually started looking at this in the lab in a human gambling game, some people are drawn to looking at the outcome. All they care is how much they're winning, and others just want to look at the cues that sparkle and jangle and, you know, and get excited about the noise. And so there could be similar operations happening in the brains of different populations of people when they engage in this game. Some are going to get very seduced by the cues and very caught up in the sensory stimulating environment, and others are going to have their eye on that bottom line area. But and the course of question for us is trying to figure out how problematic is it to be in that sign tracking sensory stimulating camp.
I think that's a very optimistic note, because there is an enormously rich seam of research in cognitive neuroscience and the cognitive psychology of attention about how this capturing process works. And for example, I think we could use techniques like eye monitoring, so gaze monitoring, to look at how players move their attention around the screen. It seems really important to me. Do we know that a player's actually looking at this information, but maybe not using it, or are they not even directing their attention to this part of the display in the first place? So we can actually combine some of the messaging work with tools like that to make some headway in disambiguating what's going on there.
I think it's interesting that like you use the same kind of eye tracking techniques when doing research on a digital environment, so a web design. You kind of like you find where people's gaze wanders to, or where they're directing their look, and that helps you optimize that experience for a particular goal. I wonder what the goal of that experience is, whether it is to enable people to consume the various bits of information appropriately to make responsible decisions or not.
I think, well, you know, yeah, how specific are these effects to slot machine play is, I think, a big question there. Like, this is a reasonably, this focus on the machine zone is a sort of hypothesis that's very much come to the forefront following Natasha Dow-Schull's work. She talks about it as a very specific influence in slot machine play, this dissociation, this complete absorption in the game that takes you out of the stresses or troubles of your day-to-day life. But there's not good data yet showing whether this is specific to slot machine gambling, or whether this cuts across other forms of casino gambling or other forms entirely. Are there any comments on the zoning while we're on this?
Oh, thanks. Just kind of connecting the points you made with this video to the last video, and the preoccupation about cues that indicate a win. Two questions about the last video, if that's okay. With the rats, I guess it's more the rats than the video. But
rats are great.
Were the high risk but higher payout, was that condition LDW?
No, not in, we have rat studies done since Luke has got here, looking at LDW effects, but they're not ready for prime time yet. But no, the risky options were always, there were genuine wins when they won, but the payout over time was lower. So they'd get sort of, if they carried on playing the risky options, they'd get 4 sugar pellets sort of 40% of the time and these longer timeouts. So they'd earn roughly a quarter as many sugar pellets as if they played with the safe but more boring options.
Right, and were the bells and whistles in both conditions of the risky ones and the safe ones?
The bells and whistles were much more exciting on the risky ones.
But they existed?
Yeah, they had much simpler tones when they won on the easier options. So there'd be a little light that flashed, a simple tone that maybe only changed in pitch once or twice, whereas the larger the reward, again, just drawing our inspiration exactly from the way sound and light cues are used in real gambling environments, the larger the reward, the more complex, the more interesting the visual cue. It wasn't any longer, but just more lights were flashing, more different tones were sounding. It was much more of an interesting cue that we used.
It was just making me think of temporal discounting or future discounting and how you can kind of have more of a short-term gratification orientation versus long-term gratification, and maybe like these sensory cues kind of shift orientation towards short-term gratification. I don't know, what do you think of that?
Yeah, so the intolerance to delay of gratification literature is very, again, another very rich cognitive area. So this is where you look at people's tendency to choose smaller sooner over larger later rewards. And so even though the size of the reward that you get later is always bigger and that never changes, for everyone there comes a point where waiting is just so tedious and it really devalues in our minds that larger reward that we instead would prefer a smaller sooner reward. So a classic example, you know, would you like $1 in 5 minutes or $10 in 15 minutes? Most of us would probably go for $10 in 15 minutes, but I said, I can have $5 in, you know, 3 minutes or $10 in a month. Well, you're not going to wait a month just for a small increase in reward. And that's a very extreme example, but you can look at titrating the delays to reward and see how it impacts choice. And one thing to bear in mind is not only is that going to be influenced by how good you are at waiting, but also how much you value those rewards. And one thing we don't know with the rats, and to a certain extent with the humans, is do those flashing lights, do they make the rewards just seem more desirable, or does it make the costs just less present in their rat minds or less of an influence on their decision making? And that's one thing we really want to get at.
Thank you.
I have a question about relative to policy. It's Gerald here, so should I stand up so you can see? So when we wrote the PHO report, I learned that BCLC has a process for rating risk on games. And I wonder if you guys look at that sort of criteria that they use for risk in some of you targeting your research. That's the first question. I mean, thinking about, in a sense, my sense is that there are people who are designing these features into machines for a lot of intention. They know exactly what they're doing. Why don't you work with them? We talk about partnering with the industry. Go to the people who are busy designing these features and say, why are you doing that? What processes do they use to figure out what to put on these machines to make them create a zone for folks, right? You could do that. The other question is, when I naively wrote a recommendation into the report to start marking the risk on the machine, so people could have informed decision making about how risky this machine is that I'm using at this moment. Later on, I learned actually that every machine that's been approved for use in our casinos are all high risk, so there's no point in doing that. Yes. So just thinking about the policy implications of some of what you're doing with that.
Yeah, I would love to know more about the scheme that BCLC have for assessing games, but there are a few schemes internationally. Richard Wood, who's here, was involved in the development of one of those schemes. And they tend to be for comparing very different kinds of forms of gambling against one another. So electronic gambling machines versus, a lottery versus, you know, Mahjong, say. And so you can think about properties like the speed of the game, the presence of near misses within the game, the presence of illusion of control, which we'll look at next. And as you say, electronic gambling machines on those scales tend to score kind of ubiquitously pretty high, and I don't know that enough attention is given to the differences between the games there. But I would love in our research to get more insights from the actual game designers. I think that's going to be key in moving forward with this.
Hi. I'm still stuck on the first video where it seems like the main message is even though people understand the fallacy exists, they still behave as though it is true, and therefore just giving people information won't help. With that in mind, do you have any thoughts about what kind of messages or maybe images or methods would help people act on what they already know, I guess? And I'm thinking here partly of Don's point as well, that maybe this is what makes it fun. So there's a payoff maybe there as well.
I think there's a couple of things. I think this idea of being able to label risks so that people can make an informed choice about what they're playing. And I think if we were to offer a variety of slot machines that varied in risk, so designers would be able to create games that varied in their risk based on this sort of research into cognitive distortions. But I also think it comes down to this difference between trying to change individuals' opinions as they're playing the machine versus changing policy, changing things at a higher level, and changing what is normal. And I think as good as awareness is in terms of trying to make people understand these myths, I'm not sure how effective that messaging is.
It would be an interesting exercise to look at a few prototype games, one which has been designed with high risk, high irresponsibility in mind, and then maybe a couple of other prototypes, and at the other end you've got a highly responsible, you know exactly where you stand, what time it is, how much money you're betting and winning and losing, and
probably no one would play
it. No one's going to play this one, are they? But it would be that there has to be, for me, there has to be some sense of responsibility taken by the game makers to inbuild responsibility and kind of, to help a collective responsibility that we all have in the gambling industry to make it a safe environment.
With an eye on time, I want to get to the last video, and the last video is a bit more of a mixed success in some ways, and we're moving away from slot machine gambling back towards a distortion that cuts across all forms of gambling. Here we're interested in the illusion of control. So the illusion of control is in a game of chance where certain features that we usually associate with skill-based games cause us to have increased confidence or increased risk-taking behavior. So this might be a high degree of familiarity with the game. This might be making some irrelevant action, like throwing a ball. It might be making some choice, like choosing one's lottery numbers. And in this video, we focused on that, designing a dice throwing game where we built a sort of rudimentary craps table, and we were interested in our participants' dice throwing behavior, whether they would throw the dice harder when they're trying to throw a high number compared to when they're trying to throw a low number. We call this the Henslin effect, after James Henslin, a sociologist who described this effect in craps players back in the 1950s. Now, the video actually has two segments to it, because we started trying to record this in UBC students in the lab, and we consistently failed to find any evidence of this effect. And so we actually brought our equipment to the New Horizons reception on Monday evening and really kind of threw everything we had at the bias. And I want to thank those delegates here who came into our green room down the hall to take part in that. So let's have a look at the video. 9. That is a 7. That is a 6. Okay, so we've got, so that's your pile there, we've got a 12. And a 4, okay.
You were tired or need to throw again.
Okay, so that is a 4 for James.
It's not the lowest.
It's not.
Same chance.
Whoa. Okay, that is a 10.
That's
again.
Mine is Ooh.
That is a 6.
Chocolate bar. Oh. Yeah, Matt's not going to get it.
That is a 6 as well.
Back
forth.
You're pretty good at rolling low.
The opposite of what's required.
Oh, 6 again.
That's pretty
okay,
good.
That is a 6. Let's go next.
Here comes double fives.
6.
That's
a 7.
What did you get?
7.
We got both 6. Come on, Matt. You can do 9.
That is a 9. I think we should have brackets at the end there, weekly. Because we did see the effect to some degree in the competitive setting, but it was a much more fragile phenomenon. I'm convinced that I show this effect myself, and my kids definitely show this effect when we play board games. But we looked for it there in terms of how long people would shake the cup for when we were using a cup. We looked at the effect in terms of the distance and in terms of that sort of the force of the actual throw itself. And it was really only in the final set of footage that I think we started to see it. But again, these are inexperienced players.
So I think this speaks to a broad range of things that we would class under this illusion of control. So ways that players can feel that they're having some control over the game, so that might come with lucky charms or feeling hot and continuing to play, feeling that they have some element of control or skill in these games of chance. And I think that this is another of the messages that needs to be given across to gamblers, that and already is with the game sense, that they have no control. But again, even telling people they have no control, still, it's still very difficult to get over that sense.
Yeah, it doesn't surprise me that somebody is, if they're wanting to throw big, if you were to throw a ball big, you'd need to throw it hard, right? And if you wanted to throw it small or short distance, then you'd throw it softly. And I can understand there's human beings find it difficult to disconnect from maybe things that they know about other environments and other, I guess, actions. They kind of, it's not natural to disconnect it from the next thing. And it doesn't, I think it's fascinating. It was hard to spot. I'm sure it's hard to spot. I've seen this video like 5 times and I still find it hard to spot, but it is there.
It's a fragile effect there, but you're right that the human brain and the brain systems involved in decision-making, involved in risk-taking, involved in reward, these are systems that are primarily evolved to learn about our environments and to acquire skills. And it's no surprise that when we bring those brain systems to bear in a gambling environment, we can end up seeing some quite strange effects like the Henslin effect. Are there any, we're running low on time, so are there any closing questions or comments regarding these?
I have one question for you that goes back to the where people focused on the outcomes, but other people focused on the cues. And have you been looking at any correlations between the desire more for the objective of achieving dissociation with cues rather than outcomes being more present-centered? And then I'm thinking about a relationship with trauma. So thinking from a clinical perspective, I'm wondering about if there's any research that you have been doing or know of that looks at that variability.
So there's lots in that question. What I can tell you is that there are considerable individual differences as to whether individuals will sign track or goal track. It has been found, there is an excellent study, again, this is more in rats than in humans, but again, the nice thing about the rat data is it kind of shows whether an effect is real, independent of metacognition, independent of thinking about it. The rats just do the behavior, and you get to look at their history. And it's been found that animals that have what they call maternal isolation, so they're taken away from their mummies just for a little bit of time every day, and they don't like that, and the mummies don't like it either, those animals are more likely to sign track. So that's work coming out of a lab in Calgary, Vedran Lovich's lab. It's very interesting data looking at exactly that thing. We can look at the whole history of the animal. We can either insert what could be traumatic events or positive beneficial events, and then look at the development of their cognition, adolescence, and then on into adulthood to try and get at exactly those kind of questions. You know, what are either the risk factors, the environmental risk factors, the circumstantial risk factors, and the biological risk factors for doing something that seems so innocuous and simple, like paying a bit more attention to cues that predict reward, it can actually have kind of potentially knock-on negative effects when you look at it in the context of a potentially addictive environment. And that's one thing I do want to emphasize from the rat data, that half our animals were not taken in by our bells and whistles at all. Like, they were able to just ignore all these flashing lights and focus on the goal, which was to earn the sugar. But some of them were much more vulnerable to the effect of those bells and whistles. And just being repeatedly exposed to this environment where there's lots of uncertainty, lots of sensory stimulation, we have shown that all the animals, whether their decision-making is good or bad, who are exposed to all those cues, end up being much more willing, or rather their decision-making is much more negatively affected by cocaine self-administration. So that's kind of a big thing to end on, but it sort of implies that some of these sensitivities that you can build through environmental exposure actually do have real knock-on effects for if you ever find yourself in an environment where illicit drugs are present. And we know there's lots of comorbidity. Having a pure gambling disorder patient is like hen's teeth. It's so rare. There's a lot of other addiction pathology built in, but they may not, you know, what's the chicken and what's the egg? We may actually be looking at exactly the same neurobiological vulnerability. And that's sort of the research that I really want to do moving forward.
In terms of the human data, we can also clearly see that early trauma and early adversity is a major risk factor for problem gambling. I think that's very well established. But whether slot machine play working through that sort of escape motivations and dissociation forms a particular cluster there, whether there's basically a particular type of problem gambler where slot machines and maybe trauma come together, I haven't seen good data supporting that yet.
Luke, I've got a question maybe about the future direction of your center. And I don't want to talk about rats as subjects, but I do want to talk about or ask you about another paper that was written by some of your colleagues at the university about the use of weird subjects or undergraduate students as subjects and how that might have some implications on the work that you're going to do in the future or perhaps in the present, especially as we know there are say special populations in the field of gaming that we have to be concerned about.
Sorry. Yeah, great question. This is a famous UBC paper now arguing that the vast majority of psychology research is done in university students who are weird, which means what, Western, educated, Industrialized, yeah. So that there's a very narrow demographic profile. So at the Center for Gambling Research, we do our research cutting across three different groups. We do some experiments in UBC students because we can recruit those very easily, but at the same time, we have to recognize that they are mostly complete novices. Personally, I do think it's useful to get players' initial formative experiences on something like a complex slot machine, but they are clearly novice players. So we do a lot of other studies. Some of the work that Spencer and Steph have shown at the meeting in the poster session is going out into the community, recruiting regular slot machine players. And we're also starting to do the first studies in Vancouver, recruiting problem gamblers into research studies, working with the BC treatment program. And so I think we really need those different approaches to come together in convergent findings. But yeah, we shouldn't rely too much upon just the one methodology.
Thank you.
I had one question about the time. I was noticing the with the responsible gambling, I was thinking about responsible gambling and having the clocks and how your students were not noticing the time at all. They didn't even realize it was there or that it had jumped up. I was just curious if that kind of, your study would then inform or pass that information along to think about how to do the responsible gambling, help supporting people to notice the time. Sometimes we have clients who talk about the not even realizing the number of hours they've been sitting playing a game. So. And I was thinking about Netflix. Sometimes I watch Netflix. And once in a while, a little thing will come up and say, do you want to still continue watching? Which kind of shows you I've probably been watching it too long. And I have to press OK to continue. And I'm just thinking about things like that, where I don't know what that would look like. But if having clocks actually on the screen or nearby isn't really effective, if there's other ways that you would recommend or you'd think about with that?
Yeah, I think with that video, we wanted to highlight the difficulties, the kind of barriers there to getting those messages across. And with pop-up messages, I think a common problem as well is that gamblers quite quickly habituate to those messages. So how can that information be delivered repeatedly in a way that is going to continue to grab players' attention? I would kind of reiterate the comment earlier that we can really rely more on the rich seam of research on attention and methods like eye tracking to try and study the conditions under which we can succeed in doing that. I think at that point, I'd like to wrap up this session. I want to thank our three panelists once again for joining me today, and I'd like to thank you for your questions from the floor, and invite Angus to come up and do the wrap-up.